let's talk about dynamic range. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Pal to Tech. One of the more important but often least understood features of your Fujifilm camera is the dynamic range setting. You'll find this in the IQ section of your camera's setting. Dynamic range is basically the range of light in your scene from the darkest areas all the way up to the lightest areas. You see, we all have a big problem: our eyes. The human eye can perceive up to 20 stops of dynamic range. From the brightest whites to the darkest darks, the human eye is capable of observing and being able to see detail in those lighting conditions. Unfortunately, cameras are not as good as your eyes. Even if you set your Fujifilm camera to shoot 10-bit F-log video, the most that this camera will be able to see is 14 stops of dynamic range. Traditionally, that's why you use a histogram. When you use a histogram, you know that if you have your highlights all shoved over onto this side of the histogram, you will be beyond the range limit of your camera being able to see any detail in those highlights. So for example, if you go to take a photo of a marshmallow, right? That marshmallow may look fine to you in the studio, but to your camera, if you don't have your exposure correct, it's going to be white and blown out. And no matter whether you shoot RAW or JPEG, you will be unable to recover that detail. Basically, it'll be pure white. Likewise, if you underexposed and your histogram is shoved all the way over to the left, you will wreck your shadows. And instead of having detail, it will be areas of pure black. Obviously, when shooting photos, it is impossible to get an even better balance of highlights and shadows all of the time. Every scene is different. And because of this, you need to make key decisions for your exposure and how far you want to go before you blow out your highlights versus pulling that back and not crushing your shadows too much. So to make this a bit easier, Fujifilm has included this dynamic range setting option with your camera. They basically wanted to give you a tool that will help to protect your highlights because those are really the most critical between the two. You can often recover your shadows, but once you blow your highlights, that's it. Game over, even with a RAW file. Your DR setting option is located in your Fujifilm camera menu under the IQ section right here. It contains four options, and if you see some of them grayed out, this is because your ISO dial is not set high enough. This is the first thing you need to know about using the DR feature. It will require you to shoot at a higher ISO value in order to work. If you see that it's grayed out, simply turn your ISO dial until you can see it appear. See that? The DR 200% setting requires a minimum ISO of 320, and the 400% requires a minimum ISO of 640. The 100% option basically means that the dynamic range feature is disabled and that your camera is not providing any additional highlight protection. Basically, they should have named this choice off instead of 100%. The next two choices, 200% and 400%, refer to the amount of highlight protection that you will get if you set it to those values. 200% is one extra stop of highlight protection, and 400% is two extra stops of highlight protection. Auto basically hands over control to the camera to decide whether or not to choose either 100%, you know, which is no dynamic range protection, or 200%. It will not apply 400% when you have it set to auto. Also, when it comes to shooting movies on your Fujifilm camera, you can use the dynamic range settings of 200% and 400%, but you cannot use the automatic setting. If you're in movie mode, you go into IQ, your dynamic range, you will see three choices there. Also, if you are shooting in F-log, in other words, you set your camera to shoot F-log right here. Now, if you go in here, you will notice that it is grayed out. You cannot get to it. This is because shooting with F-log in and of itself will give you the highest possible dynamic range at the minimum ISO value of 640. So, you know, shooting in F-log is a whole other video for a whole other time. So back to the DR settings. When you enable the dynamic range setting to, say, 400, what does that mean and what exactly is happening? In the case of 400, your minimum ISO is now 640, right? On an X-T4 and an X-T3. Now you go and you take your shot. And yes, you will get a bit more noise in your shadows. But by shooting at this ISO value of 640, now your camera has more room to work with in the amplification stage of the processing. So then what it does is it decreases amplification in only the highlight areas of your image in order to protect them. Then it will use the original ISO of 640 to amplify the shadow areas of your image and also some of the mid-tones, right? So that basically the highlights are processed with a lower ISO and the shadows are processed with a higher ISO, all in the same shot before the image is sent to the analog to digital converter. Then everything else is as normal and it saves the file to your SD card. Something very important to know is that these process changes are baked into your file, whether you shoot JPEG or whether you shoot RAW. Let's take a look now, it'll be real clear. Here are three images I shot taken at dynamic range of off or 100%, 200%, and 400%. Let's compare the one that's off with 400% so it'll be more clear, especially when looking at it through a small screen on a YouTube video. First, let's have a look at the JPEG straight out of the camera files. For these JPEGs, I use the film simulation of Pro Negative Standard. So the photo on the left is a dynamic range of 100% or off. The photo on the right is at 400%. All other settings on the camera are exactly the same. Look at the marshmallow detail here at 100%. Clearly, you can see more detail in the white areas, the highlights of the image. There is slightly more noise in the shadows in the 400% dynamic range, but the trade-off is that we get more details in the highlight areas of our image. Now let's look at the RAW file and prepare to have your minds blown. These files look pretty much identical, like basically it had no effect on the RAW file, which leads many people to conclude erroneously that RAW files are not affected by this. But remember I told you that this process happens before, and the key is before, the image is sent to the analog to digital converter. So before that happens is when all of this processing takes place. Have a look at this. So here's the first one shot at dynamic range of 100%, or basically off. I'm turning down my highlights as far as I can go in Lightroom. Next, I'm gonna do the exact same thing to the image that I shot at 400% dynamic range. Have a look at this. Can you believe that? These are raw images. The only difference was that one of them was shot at 100% dynamic range, the other at 400% in the camera, and yet when I come into Lightroom on a RAW file, I'm able to decrease the highlight slider by 5 stops and be able to get back that lost detail. You see that? Now let's see how much noise there might be in the shadow areas. For each image, I'm going to turn up the shadows as far as I can. Look at that. I am at 200% here. If I back off to 100%, you can see more the range of what's going on here. These are gone, blown out, lost forever. And because I set the dynamic range on the camera to 400% and gave up a little bit of higher ISO, you know, a little bit of ISO noise, look at the difference it made. 400%. These are raw images at 100% dynamic range, 200% dynamic range, and 400%, okay? This time I will turn down the exposure by 5 stops and I'll turn down the highlights as far as I can go. Let's see if there's any image detail that's saved. Down goes the exposure. Oh my goodness. Have a look at that. Can you believe it? Look at that. These are raw images. I had the exact same settings to the sliders. All I did to each one of them was turn the exposure slider down 5 stops and the highlight slider down as far as I could go. Look at the difference in detail from the raw file. This is not the JPEG, it's the raw file. The dynamic range setting is incredibly important to both raw files and JPEGs. Now keep in mind, this is not what you want to be doing doing for filmmaking. If you are dealing with dynamic range and you want to get the most out of the camera, then you need to be shooting in F-log. That is another video for another time. So I think from this video, we can draw some conclusions. The first is that, without question, your raw files are affected by the settings that you choose in the dynamic range function. Because selective ISO is being amplified from the analog amplifier before the raw file has been created, it is in fact baked into the raw file itself. Secondly, I think that the dynamic range setting is an important setting for you if you want to have a bit more control in protecting your highlights in certain kinds of dynamic range scenes that you're shooting. What you need to decide is that if the trade-off of protecting your highlights is worth the extra noise that you may end up seeing in your shadows by using the higher ISO values. Regardless of these two points, I want to strongly emphasize that this dynamic range feature in your Fujifilm camera is in no way a replacement for having good exposure and being able to properly use a histogram to know exactly whether or not you're blowing out your highlights and having that level of control over your scene. Think of it as an additional tool that can help you in certain situations, but not a substitute for proper exposure. Now, there is an additional tool that I did not discuss in this video that relates to dynamic range, and that is the D-Range Priority tool that's available in the X-T2, X-T3, and X-T4 cameras. The D-Range Priority tool builds upon the Dynamic Range tool, and it allows you greater control over the tone curve. I didn't want to get into this tool in this video because I really want you to have a solid understanding of the initial and more important Dynamic Range tool and how it affects RAW files. I want you to go out and practice with it and try it out if you've not already used it. You'll see the difference yourself. I will be doing another video specifically on the D-Range tool soon enough. Well, thank you so much for watching, and I hope this video has been helpful to you. If it has, be sure to give it the like and subscribe. Also, I have a newsletter, and if you would like to be notified whenever I publish a new video, you can go ahead and subscribe to it. I will have a link to it down below. In the meantime, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in another video again real soon. Take care.